Okay, we're live, I guess. Let me.
Hey, everyone. It is Trigger Warning with Antonia Okafor and
Nina Privo. Nice to see you all. If we're after live, let's make sure that we are. Oh, yeah, we are. Oh, my God.
Yes. Antonia Okafor and.
Yeah. Okay, yeah.
Now it's doing feedback. Oh, did you just like you on purpose?
So you can hear it? I only just checked it to make sure we were live, but we're
okay.
The feedback should be gone now. We are definitely live, and someone already made a comment. So
we're awesome. yes. At midnight, 12, no, even it's more than 12:45.
One.
Oh my goodness. Guys, we had this whole thing. I think it's important. As Nina says, it's endearing when you hear things like this, when you hear that we had this whole long video thing we did with live at 11 o'clock our time. And we were like on it. Nina was on it. She was passionate. She was about to cry. Like I was about to cry. It was amazing. And then we go off. We're like, this is one of the best things that we've ever done. So important to society. Go into the YouTube channel and find actually only Jesus saw it because did not record.
It did not record. It was not even, I guess it did not even all at all record. It said we were live. Live where? Who knows?
I know. I'm like, that's what I'm feeling like. It's somebody just extracted that live feed, right, and is waiting to use it in the most opportune time for us. And both of our times when we want some type of career, I don't know what, but they'll choose, I'm guessing. And but, we'll use it against us. I don't know.
But yeah, so this is time two. Hopefully it's just as effective as time one. But at least it's functioning this time, so it's already better in that regard.
Yeah. We have a timer for 30 minutes, so already it's almost three minutes of just talking about nonsense. So let's get to it, guys. So as the title suggests, we are going to talk about what unfortunate thing that happened yesterday. Now, in France, the burning of Notre Dame. Nina, I want you to really take the lead on this. Nina, you're Catholic, right? And can you just kind of explain a little bit more about your faith? But I mean, really let's talk about Notre Dame first, and we can definitely talk about your faith next. But this is devastating.
Oh, yeah. I mean, this made me upset almost embarrassingly earlier. I mean, I was crying. I cried multiple times thinking about it. And yeah, I'm a Catholic, and I also have very strong French ancestry. Like, I think it makes up nearly 60% of my background. So my heart is with La France. And I also, it's like my 30 times great aunt is Joan of Arc. So I actually am it's kind of random, but I'm a French spirit, and Seeing Notre Dame burn to the ground today really jarred me. I've been to Notre Dame multiple times, and I went to Mass there at least once. And, you know, there's a little, like, placard on the ground outside. You know, they have, like, cement tiles, but there's a little placard outside. And I remember my French teacher in, I think it was eighth grade, when the first time I went, and she was telling us how if you step on this placard, like, that ensures that you'll get to go back to Notre Dame. You know, it's like this special kind of piece of the architecture, and it's like, you know, you love it, you want to come back, this is where you go. And so I went when I was 13. I also went in 2009 when I was studying abroad in Italy. I went back, and so I touched the stone again. And today I was just so devastated to see that, like, a part of my history and a part of my, I don't know, like, my religious tradition, my cultural tradition, my ethnic heritage had really just been, like, taken away from us like that.
Yeah.
I don't know. It was really heartbreaking for me. So that's what it means to me. Notre Dame to me is more than just a building. You know, it's a symbol. It's a symbol of Christianity and specifically Catholicism, because it is a Catholic church. But it's also a symbol of French culture. It's a symbol of Western civilization, and it's a symbol of beauty. So to see it get destroyed today, it just broke my heart. I didn't know what to do with myself.
Yeah, no, I am still internally reeling from it as well. So my background is that I was born and raised Roman Catholic. Born and raised. I know those people would be like, "Why you gonna be born?" Well, okay, I guess you're baptized. I was baptized when I was a baby to be Roman Catholic. But anyways, I left the faith, right? Left the faith to become a Protestant, I guess. Born again Christian through that sense. But anyways, I mean, my family is still Roman Catholic and strong Roman Catholic background still today. In fact, my mom still believes that is, other than also not becoming a doctor, because that is a Nigerian tradition, right? But other than that, you gotta become a doctor, one. And then two, you also have to remain Catholic, which I did not become either of those things. So I am ashamed. And also, I'm a conservative. You know, three strikes. She still loves me. So it works out. But anyways, I digress. Like, yeah, so they're still Roman Catholic. And so that's a big part of them. And I mean, I think it's still going to be a big part of me. Like, that's what I grew up with. I went to CCD, and which is, for those who don't know, like, basically, like, you know, well, you might know better than me. I don't even know what it actually stands for. But other than calling it CCD, I just know it was like every week on Wednesday, we'd go and learn about being Catholic, what it takes to be Catholic, I guess, basically. And you're like,
maybe I'm a bad Catholic. Like, I have no idea what that
is. Oh, you don't know what I'm talking about?
No. I was terrible, though. I never liked to go to youth group or anything like that. I was very much like a Catholic who enjoyed mass and, like, would read scripture and, like, enjoy the music. And that was pretty much it. So, yeah.
We have a name for those Catholics. Just kidding.
They call us all kinds of things.
And by the way, I know we were, like, earlier, we were making fun of, like, who's a stronger Catholic, your mom or my mom? When you said Eucharist, I was like, actually, my mom's name is Eucharia. That's her name, the Eucharist. But what's your mom's name?
it's not that religious, girl. It's not that close. So there you go. Cheryl.
You sorry. What? Oh, it's Cheryl. It's okay, Cheryl.
She's wonderful. She's a great Catholic, a much better Catholic.
Well, okay, but anyway, I know, I was like, where was the beginning of this conversation? People are like, okay, get back to it. So, but basically, I mean, that it did have an impact on me. Obviously, I think I'm still trying to fully process the whole thing of, like, wow, this is this piece of history that's been around for hundreds of years, almost 1,000, is gone. Just gone in a blink. One day it's gone. And it just definitely, you know, my fiance and I are planning on going to Europe for our honeymoon. We're going to Italy because that's my thing. But still, it just, how quickly we take things for granted and how things that have been around in human, you know, years, hundreds of years, is big for us, right, as human beings. But you know, just goes to show how quickly and how our life is a vapor, and the things that we've made, man-made things, are a vapor, and then they don't last. So you have to appreciate them when you can. So, and we also don't know how this happened too. I think that's going to add more tragedy to this if this happens to be a terrorist attack, or even just a symbolism of. You know, I mean, and that's the thing is too, is that people think terrorist attack, you think, you know, people are killed. But terrorism is meant, its sole purpose is to create chaos. That is the sole purpose of terrorism. It's not necessarily to end life, which we're glad that no one was, you know, killed from this or even injured, that I know of, at least of that aspect. A lot more artifacts and things like that. But at the end of the day, it's to tear down symbols, like Western civilization symbols, like things that have to do with Catholicism. So I hope it's nothing to do with this. I'm not going to start, you know, Yeah, what do you think? I mean, do you think it could be, or are you just, I don't know. I know it's hard to even try guess.
A couple of things about what you said. Like, the first thing is, it is amazing how quickly this happened, you know, because I've been planning a trip back to Europe, and I never would have guessed that, like, I couldn't see Notre Dame, you know? Like, the idea that I would go to Paris and that, like, would not be something I could see is just so heartbreaking. And I was talking to both my mother and my fiance about this, and neither of them have been there. Like, they haven't been to Paris. So I was just thinking about how lucky I am to have seen it as many times as I have. But also just to think about how we do take these things for granted. We think about things with permanency that really don't have it. Especially something like a piece of architecture. We think it'll just exist forever, but and that's the thing. Like, I don't know what happened or like what caused it. And I try to be careful with conspiracy type stuff. But it's really heartbreaking to me to think about, like, if it was an accident, and that's what they've been saying, that it was part of the renovations that they were doing, and that's what instigated the fire. And if that's the case, that's just so tragic, you know, for that to happen. And it makes me wonder, like, symbolically, like, what this means. Like, if it was just an accident that all of Notre Dame could burn to the ground, pretty much. I mean, I saw the video of the spire falling down, and that, like, literally brought me to tears. And I was in public when I watched that. Like, I just was on my phone, and I saw it, and I was just, like, crying in the post office. Yeah, it's pretty sad. But I also saw, like, a photo of afterwards, when, like, after the roof had collapsed all the way around, and it was in the shape of a cross, because that's how the cathedral is shaped, right? So from above, it just looked like this giant, like, flaming cross in Paris, you know?
Wow.
And all of this imagery is just so biblical to me. Like, it's just, it makes me think a lot about, you know, the state of Europe, the state of Christianity, specifically in Europe, and whether or not they're willing to fight to preserve, like, that which is their culture and that which is beautiful. And ultimately it's that which is kind of Christian, you know? But even if you're an atheist, like, if you've walked into Notre Dame and seen the stained glass behind the altar, you know, that is a piece of art that we should all want to protect and be devastated to lose, you know, because it's more than just a building where people have, like, mass, you know.
Absolutely.
Like, Notre Dame is a symbol of France. It's a symbol of Catholicism. It's a symbol of Western beauty. You know, like, I get on this, like, rant about it, but it's just so much more than a building. And I don't know. I really hope that it wasn't an act of terrorism, you know, because the implications of that would be so much more heartbreaking to me, because that would mean that there are people who are actively trying to destroy that which is, like, beautiful about Western civilization, like, not even just to do harm to the people who live here or to our politicians or something like that, but to actively attack something that's, like, so gorgeous. Like, even the Nazis, like, didn't blow up Notre Dame, you know what I mean? So I genuinely pray and hope that it was an accident. Like, I really hope that that's the case, because otherwise, I don't know, my faith in humanity is not that strong, but that would be cause for me to, like, lose it, you know, because it's just such a piece of art, and I don't know, a little part of me, like, died today with that. And I know that's dramatic, but it's, like, true, so.
No, I mean, and it's crazy. I remember you were talking about also earlier of how, you know, the people who built, you know, Notre Dame it's not like, you know, we're going to build it again. And I know you were saying that that's what the French president said that he's going to do, but it's just like, first of all, it's crazy to me to think, you know, 1,000 years from now, if they do rebuild it, and 1,000 years from now, they're going to think in the history books, well, that first time that Notre Dame was, you know, burned down, hopefully never again, until Christ comes again. But, that this will be in the history books, and that they will lose out on that part of history that we got to see. I mean, you got to see. I didn't get to see that. So many people didn't get to see that. And I wonder what they're going to do next. I mean, do you think they would just not build something because it would be – do you think they would even go that far, or do you think they have to – they almost have to? They have to build something.
I feel like they're going to try to rebuild it, you know? I mean it's kind of interesting because some of the architectural techniques that were used to build some of these cathedrals, like, we as modern peoples, like, don't even know how they did all of that. Like, there's some parts of the craftsmanship that we like don't understand and like might not be able to replicate perfectly. But I do think that with our technology, like they've done a lot of 3D modeling and things, so they've probably 3D modeled like every inch of Notre Dame. And I bet that they'll be able to make a replica that was really close. But the thing to me that was so special about it is not just that it exists, but that it was built by men who had such primitive technology compared to us, and that it's such a extravagant and grand building, like with such limited technology. Like we have so much technology at our fingertips today, and when we build new buildings, they're just like big boxes that are just like gray and brown and whatever, and there's no
Colorado.
Yeah, I know, seriously, Colorado architects, like maybe you get a little bit creative. But really, it's like, I think that there's been kind of a crisis in architecture, but like Notre Dame is one of those examples of just something where like the people who built that, first of all, to build a cathedral, you have to, I mean, think about how much effort and time goes into building a cathedral. Like it's like decades, if not hundreds of years to get something like that accomplished, especially with the technology that they had. So these men were like driven by a faith and or like a fear of God that I don't think anyone who's alive now like even understands, to put in that kind of effort and blood and sweat and tears into building a structure like that. But the very fact that they were willing to do that embodies meaning into that structure, you know, because now even if we can rebuild it, it's like, well, we're rebuilding something to have a memory of something that we lost, you know, but it's not really, it's like, I got to walk in the building that was like hand, like they like hand carved those etchings at the door, you know, like all that Gothic stuff, all those details, like that was all done by hand, you know? And I don't know. I like lit a candle in there, you know, it's just gone. Like I'm just, it's just devastating. I'll stop ranting.
Well, I mean, it does. I mean, I love your passion. And I think one thing that also hurt to see comments of people, you know, I posted the video of it and stuff like that. And I just remember somebody saying, it's a Catholic symbol. It's not a Christian symbol. You know, stop trying to, you know, put the two together. And I mean, I just feel like, and that's part of why we're here now, like, Nina, just can you set the record straight on that whole thing? Because I mean, I wrote it, I'm probably going to bring it out again. Bring out the Bible, Antonia.
Bring out that Bible
and see. At least I know, like, I'm not going to say the wrong scripture. But
I feel like not only, like, first of all, that's offensive for a couple of reasons. Like, number one, to assume that Catholics aren't Christians is just bonkers to me. Like, I don't understand
Christian,
that.
And then I'm pretty sure there was, like, this thing with Martin Luther, and then it was, like, Protestants, and then it was Catholics. But,
yeah,
what am I to say about history? But, I mean, the thing is that in scriptures, but what does it say? The word is near you, in your mouth, and in your heart. This is the word of faith that this is the word of faith that we proclaim, because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved.
Right.
So, Nina,
New Testament goodies, the letter to the Romans. I mean, frankly, this is something that I deal with as a Catholic all the time. We're criticized a lot, and I think that, like, I've just always thought that we and the Protestants were like on the same team, you know, like we might have disagreements about the nitty gritty about, especially about stuff like the Eucharist and maybe about like, that whole apostolic succession and stuff like that. And whether a papacy should exist and all that kind of stuff. Like, you know, we have disagreements, but I have never understood that we were like not part of the same over
club,
like umbrella of a religion, which is Christianity and which is like following Christ. So to have anybody say that the loss of Notre Dame is something that only Catholics should care about is just insane to me. It's like this is a symbol of Christianity too. Like, even if you're not a Catholic, like a cathedral is more than just like a bastion of Catholicism specifically. Mm-hmm. Like it is it's paying homage to Christ and like giving glory to God to build a structure of like that. And that's what I talk about when like men shed like blood and like sweat to create something so beautiful. Like they're doing it to honor God and like for the glory of God. So to say that like a Catholic cathedral with all of its beauty, like And that's, this is one of the things I said earlier when we were recording. Even if you're an atheist, like if you walk into if you walked into Notre Dame, it would touch you and like move you, you know, because it's just genuinely beautiful. Like even if you're not a believer, the whole point is that you're like, and that's why they built it this way, right? Like all the way the steeples go up and the arches go up, like it all brings your eyes up to the heavens. And then you get to see this beautiful piece of stained glass, you know, that is just so intricate and so detailed. And even if they recreate it, it's like, how can you say that it's the same, you know? So I'm sure that they'll rebuild it. It can't have the meaning that it did because we have the capabilities that we have in terms of building, and because we will be building it for the purpose of making sure that one of our artifacts isn't destroyed, not building it because we have this creative passion and this drive to, you know, show our faith and to show our culture and to show our morality like to the world.
Yeah. So, and that's what Europe also has lost, is that faith of, you know, being in a theology class back in college and realizing, well, you know, them focusing on the fact that Europe is on this trend of, you know, being less religious, which I know some people, the word religious, even the other people who, you know, are born again, don't like the word religious because it's, that tends to be more about traditions and, you know, the things that you do versus the way you feel about Christ and your relationship with him, which is most important. And I believe that's so, but I also think it's become more secular in Europe in general. And so I wonder, and I hope, actually my prayer is that those who had seen this thing as, I mean, if we think it as an everyday thing, we're not even around it. Those people who lived near it, who baptized their kids in it, who married in it, it more as something than bigger than themselves, bigger than that, and bigger than religion, because the people who built that were, again, they were paying reverence. They were showing their fear of God, their love of God, of Jesus Christ. And that's why they put those blood, sweat, and tears into it. So hopefully we can get more of that back into Europe as well, to see the beauty of Christ in all things.
Right. Yeah, and I have thoughts on that, and then we have like three little comments, and then I'll talk about those. But but I do want to comment on that too, before I get to that, because I do hope that, as tragic as this is, I really hope that it kind of lights a fire in the belly of Europeans, or kind of, you know, wakes them up from their slumber of suicidality with their culture, because Europeans keep, I know a lot of Europeans I know, and I dated a German guy for a while, they've been ashamed of their culture, and it's the same thing with like being ashamed of colonialism and whiteness and whatever history that we think is patriarchal and evil and whatever. They're so concerned about that they've kind of forgotten all of the good that European culture has done. And the thing is that European culture has brought more beauty to this world than any culture that I can think of. Like, especially like France and Italy and stuff, like the kind of artistic works that have originated from these countries are just so, such a gift to the world. I personally am not willing to abandon them. Like, I will stand up for them as much as I have to. But I really hope that the European people of can take this loss and use it to move forward in like a positive way and say, you know, oh my gosh, we've been in kind of this haze thinking that our culture was so awful, but now that we've lost something so beautiful, maybe we can realize the beauty that we've created and try to actually protect it from the world that might do it harm. Mm-hmm. Because there's so much in Europe to protect, and I don't know, hopefully something good comes out of this, because otherwise it's just so awful.
Absolutely.
I don't know how to handle it. And then, yeah, let me just read these comments real quick. So, KEC says, I think the cause is likely due to the repairs. A faulty electrical power cord is most likely. So, I don't know what you think.
Yeah, we're hoping. We're all hoping that's what it is. So,
yeah, I agree. I really hope that's the case. Let's see. Tillet for Connecticut says, Modern buildings are just so ugly compared to the old architecture. Yeah, absolutely. I agree with you 100%. I already have like too many things that I'm passionate about, but you know, in another life I might become an architect just so I can make some like buildings that are actually attractive. Like I'm so sick of these just boxes made with like metal and gray and whatever. So
yeah, and Colorado. Anyways, yeah, so true.
Colorado. Get it together. Let's see.
Throw in some brick in there. Come on.
Joshua Jackson says it was satanic and it had demons sitting atop it. Imagine all the demonic S that took place behind those doors within the last 600 some years. Well, you know, I will admit, like, all of Gothic architecture has a darkness to it. That's true, you know. But it's not like the Bible is free of Satan. I don't know. I just think that when you're going to depict the spiritual, you end up depicting evil too. Yeah. And Gothic architecture is purposely dark. It's part of what makes it beautiful.
And I don't agree with that at all. I mean, I think that's part of it. The disconnect that we have in American culture is, or even in the West, maybe a little more so. It's just, we talk about all the time. You see other cultures that are so in touch with the fact that the spiritual realm is not just the aspect of heaven, but there's hell and the demonic aspect that comes with it. And it is foolish of us to not incorporate both of that and to be not to be fearful of those things as well. Obviously, we shouldn't have fear in the fact that it's debilitating because we have the power of Christ behind us and we have that love and protection that way. But it doesn't change the fact that there is something demonic and evil and that there's a prince of the air. And I think that's back then that they had they're more in tune with that. Even now, you go to different countries like Africa, even Nigeria, even my parents and my grandparents, they are so much more in tune with the facts of the realities of the spiritual world and the spiritual realm. And that sounds charismatic and that sounds whatever. It's biblical. It doesn't sound whatever. It's not feeling. It's a biblical, and we should be aware of it. Not be fearful of it, but be aware. And I think it's important that we did have sculpture. We did have architecture like that that pointed to both. It's a reality.
And I think that's actually one of the reasons why Jordan Peterson has been so compelling in his like psychological interpretations of at least Genesis, is because he's not sugarcoating the world, you know, because the thing is, the world is not just good. Like, you can talk about like, oh, look at all the great stuff we have. And it's true. Like, you should be so grateful for the world and like thankful for what you have and like all of that. But you also have to be aware of the evil in the world and be prepared to encounter it and be prepared to encounter malevolence and all of that. Because if you're not prepared for it, like it can destroy you when you encounter it. So it's important to know it. I'm a sucker for Gothic architecture and all of that. Like, I actually kind of like some of the more dramatic, like kind of darker aspects of that architecture, because I do think that part of the reason why it's such great art, is because it has the beauty and the darkness blended together, just like life is.
Yeah.
And let's see what else we got here. Tillet again, a revival of sorts in the arts as well as in seeking God again.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
I mean, we need that for sure. It's actually one of the reasons why I've been practicing my painting so much, is because I keep saying like, oh man, we really need more artists who aren't just like postmodernists who believe everything's ugly and like whatever. And it's like, well, sure. If I believe that, then maybe I should be one. So that's part of the reason why I practice painting. It's like, at some point, hopefully I can actually paint like religious paintings that are compelling. I'm not sure if I'll be able to, but we'll find out. Let's see what else we got. Whatever the cause, heads will roll for this. Yeah, that's probably true. My friends are pretty ticked off. And I'm upset too, so
yeah.
I don't have anything else to say on that.
Well, so before we we're definitely already at the 30-minute mark. Of course, yeah. It's good, but great questions, guys. We're gonna move on to the next topic, and the next topic is about the fact that a lighter topic, right? Bill Weld has decided to enter the race. Our favorite libertarian VP, Bill Weld, has, and former Republican governor and pro-gun advocate. Absolutely not. Decided that he is going to join the presidential race in 2020, but not as a libertarian, as I expected him to be. He's joining as a Republican against Trump. So Nina, take it away on that one. What do you think as a libertarian? What do you think about this?
Well, I just want to go on the record for like all libertarians out there that we didn't like Bill Weld in 2016 either. We really didn't. And I think that Bill Weld from the beginning was always kind of one of these like rhino Republican neocon types. That's one of the things that was so crazy, you know, the Libertarian Party, they chose Gary Johnson to be their nominee, but he would have forced the bakery in my home state here of Colorado to bake the wedding cake, and that doesn't seem very libertarian to me on many levels. I gotta say, like, forcing someone to provide services to someone else regardless of what it is seems anti-libertarian to me. But the thing about Bill Weld that was so strange is that he had never even been a libertarian anyway. Like, he didn't even pretend to be one. He had always been a Republican.
I heard from that is that he was a great fundraiser, though. He's going to be great for fundraising. Okay, guys.
The Libertarian Party would do better just to make sure that all of their candidates actually have a website before the election happens, okay? Because before the most recent election, I looked up some of the candidates for, like, Congress and, like, local office. No websites happening. It's like, pay for a free WordPress, or not pay, get a free WordPress, okay? And just, like, put it up and have something so that people can find you. Anyway, I'm off on a rant, but my point with Bill Weld is that he didn't have a chance in hell as the libertarian, like, VP candidate, partially because Gary Johnson was awful and had so many gaffes, like the whole Aleppo thing. But I think the bigger thing is that, first of all, he's trying to challenge Trump. And, like, I didn't vote for Trump, all right? I'm willing to admit that. I'll probably get hate for that, but it's just true. I didn't vote for Trump for various different reasons. Including some stuff he said in some of the debates. But I also didn't vote for Gary Johnson, and I am a libertarian. Like, I'm not a part of the Libertarian Party anymore because I found out that they're not actually libertarians. But I think that the real issue is that someone like Bill Weld challenging Donald Trump is that he doesn't understand why Trump won in the first place. So I don't think he has any hope of beating him. Like, I just don't. Because I called the election really early, and it was because I understood that the American people were sick of political correctness. They were sick of being told they were racist bigots or whatever. Like, especially when, oh my gosh, yay! Sorry, someone in the comments just said they liked McAfee. And that's what I was saying. He should have been the libertarian candidate. Thank you, Tell It From Connecticut. I totally agree with you.
You made of Nina very happy. Thank you.
It's true. It's very true. But yeah, I think that anyone who is going to try to challenge Trump, especially on the right, is just doomed unless they understand this idea of the American people wanting someone who's just going to speak their mind, even if they disagree with what is said. So they want and who will tell them what they perceive as the truth, even if it's not something that they, like, are happy to hear. Because we've just been lied to and lied to and lied to, and politicians just have all of this, like, schmoozing rhetoric that just says nothing, you know? Like, you could watch hours of debate and learn nothing about candidates, right? But Trump would say something that just had everyone like, you know? And that's why he won. Like, his personality is why he won. And someone, I'm going to say it again, but Bill Weld is like warm cream soda. Like,
every time you trigger me, every time you say that, the visual, the
it's just so gross, right? But that is totally what he is. He's just warm cream soda, and he doesn't have a chance in hell. He has less of a chance than all of the Democrats who are going to be having a circular firing line at each other. Like,
at least some of them are likable. Again, I still forget his name again. I'm still forgetting his name. Oh, well. But the former Bill, the former Ohio governor. He's
multiple
of that guy.
We tried to record earlier too.
Maybe he doesn't deserve me to remember his name. Maybe that's what it is. I don't know.
He's so forgettable that it's like, whatever. And then meanwhile, I mean, this is kind of a side note, but I was so tickled when I saw that Kristen Gillibrand in a poll received 0% among Democrats behind quote unquote somebody else, which is just like anybody who's not running. It's like
there could be more
heard Kristen Gillibrand. It's like, yeah, she deserves that 0%.
Well, that's what you get when you run on identity politics alone. Like, if we're gonna run on any type of identity politics, it is going to be this presidential election. Literally, I mean, I always forget. Is it Kamala? It's Kamala, right? Kamala. Yeah, whatever. I was like, it's always what I think it is, or not what I think it is. Exactly the opposite of what I think it is. And I always think I'm doing like really progressive way of saying it. Anyways, probably saying it wrong. Harris. Okay. And she, and you're like, oh, she's a black woman. You don't even know her name. Okay. Yeah. Well, sorry. But she is basically just running on, and so is Cory Booker, maybe even a little bit, even less so, of just blackness, like running on being black, on literally just on her blackness and race. And then,
which is offensive to me, but whatever.
I know. I mean, the fact that, again, it's offensive because for me, it's just that we're like this monolithic group and we all have these certain ideas and we all think the same way and we have these certain needs and backgrounds, like as if we're not a diverse set of people with different types of backgrounds and crazy things like, you know, the individual and focusing on that person. It's not, it's crazy.
Oh my God. Their character and stuff.
Yeah. All that. There a lot of them are Cory Booker. A lot of them are just, you know, the features female or just whatever, what have you. They're focusing on all these identity politics to run on, and they will get their cohort. They will get their group, right? Their demographic that they're trying to appeal to. I guess, I mean, even Colorado has a former governor who's running for office, and I'm sure he's going to try and appeal to certain people too. And then of course Howard Schultz, who's just appealing to all Starbucks employees. So so it's going to be great identity politics 2020.
That's what's so crazy too, like the former governor of Colorado who's running, Hickenlooper, like he is not one of my favorite people, okay? Like his policies are like not stuff I'm on board with, but that guy is at least a sane person. Like he's
a capitalist, probably, for one.
Yeah. I don't know if he would like go on record saying that now, because people have gone so insane and like down the rabbit hole that like saying you're a capitalist is a bad word now, even though capitalism has really like brought so many people out of poverty. But anyway, but he, in terms of his policies, he's actually like relatively moderate compared.
Oh, yeah.
But that's why he's also doomed, you know, because the Democratic, that's the thing, like the Democratic Party, I don't trust to actually think about what the American people want or what will be the easiest to win. Because just like in 2016, they sabotaged Bernie Sanders, even though he had all of the fire behind him. Like they promoted Hillary Clinton, even though she was a losing candidate, and sabotaged Bernie. And I would have never voted for Bernie anyway, but if I were a Bernie supporter, like, I would be so ticked off about how that was handled. And I just don't, I think.
But they won, though.
Bernie
they
is won. More of a moderate now compared to, like, a lot of these people. Like, the left has just gone so far off the deep end because they, I think that it's maybe because of Twitter or social media and how, like, all these extreme leftists are so loud on there. Like, they think that that's how most Americans think, but it's just not true. Like, even most liberals don't think like that. So
just wait until AOC eventually runs for president.
Oh, God, think about that time. Oh, God. If a Biden runs for office, like, or, like, for president, like, I might have to run, too, and I don't want to. Like, don't make me.
I don't really care that she's a bartender, because she could be a bartender and be like impeccable on I really don't, I mean, I use it, this is coming from Nigerian you know, a daughter of Nigerian immigrants saying, you know, I've really changed my mind on the education aspect of things, of when it comes to education, higher ed education, and then education of those who, I know so many intelligent people who are doing whatever, mechanic, yeah, whatever, and they know, they can school me on so many things because they're educated and they know what they're talking about. It's crazy. They're well read. And it's really not what you're doing in life right now. It's what you're doing with that life. And regardless if she's a bartender or she was a rocket scientist, yeah, whatever, she's just wrong on so many issues. And she's also making 29-year-olds look bad like me.
Yeah. So, I know. The reason why I always refer to her as the bartender is it actually has nothing to do with like anything being wrong with being a bartender. Like I actually was a waitress for a long time and like had like a bartending role. It's more that she wants AOC to be her like name and like branding. And I just don't want to use it.
I know. But yeah, here we are using it.
I know. And like saying her whole name out is like challenging. Like I stumble over it. So for me, the bartender is just easier. And bartender, okay, makes her kind of like, it makes her sort of more of an anonymous, like just whatever politician. But I actually, I have a lot of respect for bartenders. Bartenders are much better at math than she is. Anyway, but yeah, I'm sure that she will have a target on my back for saying that because she likes to threaten private citizens with recourse if they criticize her. But yeah, I mean, that's the thing that's so scary though, is that if she ran for president, like she might win, because she has a lot of Trumpian tactics in how she deals with her following and how she approaches the public, because all of this, like, not factually accurate, but like morally right. Like that's that actually has been Trump's MO. Like the whole like, oh, remember what, like, just remember what happened in Sweden last night. Maybe there wasn't anything specifically last night that happened in Sweden, but in general, there's been problems in Sweden, right? So factually, there might be like a little error there, but on the big picture, he's like saying something that's important. And that's how the bartender's like followers think. It's like, even if she got these like facts wrong, she, on the big scheme of things, the big picture in terms of the direction she's going, we're on board. And that's why she's so freaking dangerous. Because the direction she's going is like horribly awful dystopian, just nightmare. So we gotta curtail that as much as we can. And I went on a rant, but I just wanted to explain why I say bartender. Because I respect bartenders. I'm not trying to be bold. I'm really not.
Love you, bartenders. Please don't at us. Thank you.
Yeah, don't add us. Don't add.
Especially not with AOC. Don't tag AOC either. The bartender. So, but yeah, on that note, we're gonna end on that note. But do we have any more anybody with more comments or anything like that or more questions?
I don't know if we have more questions, but Tillett from Connecticut said a few more things. He said, let's see, I never understood the libertarian ticket in 2016. Yeah, me neither, man. I think
we have Aldo. None.
I was talking to Antonia before about how, like, the way the Libertarian Party chooses their candidates is just at the national convention, they kind of have people vote after a debate happens. But clearly, Gary Johnson was not the right choice. And if I had been there, like, I watched the debates, and if I had been there, I would have voted for McAfee for sure. As insane as he was, because he is kind of insane, like, I'm willing to admit that. But if anyone was going to challenge Trump or make a scene or make a splash in that, from the Libertarian Party, it was McAfee. And, we did not even give him a chance.
McAfee has, kids, right? Like multiple kids.
I don't know if he has kids, but I know that he married a woman that like had been like a prostitute that he had like,
yeah, like, I remember that.
Like, that was recently. Services from her and then like married her. And he's living like pretty much on his yacht. Just like with Bitcoin and like is doing whatever he wants. Like he's just, I mean, he's living the anarcho-capitalist dream, I suppose. Like that's what he's doing. But especially in 2016, he was certainly the most sane of the libertarians, because at the time Austin Peterson hadn't really honed in his game yet. Mm. He was speaking a lot of platitudes. So I think that's what did him in. But Gary Johnson just isn't even a libertarian. So I don't know. That's really the bigger issue. And I think that's why we lost.
Yeah, no one understands 2016, though. The Libertarian ticket, the Republican ticket, or the Democrat ticket. So,
all of them were a mistake.
If you can understand it, you'd need to write our best-selling book, and because it will be best-selling, if you can understand what happened. Nina, as always, thank you so much for joining me. For those who are interested in seeing us again later tonight, because it really is now.
It's gonna be the same day.
It's the same day. later tonight, it's gonna be pretty late too. We're gonna be speaking with Rachel Malone from Gun Owners of America. We are so excited because we're biased for. You know, gun loving girls who are doing their thing on the Capitol. So yeah, we're gonna have her as our special guest, and it's gonna be great. So make sure you bring your questions. It's also gonna be live, we think, for now, as long as we don't mess things up. You know, text speaking.
We'll do our best with technology and our limited skills in that regard.
Yeah, someone help us, please. We need a producer. So
we actually do need a producer.
Yeah, we actually do. It's actually very simple. So email us at triggerwarning2a@gmail.com because we have an email now. Because we're cool.
Yeah, especially if you're not able to tune in live, but you would like us to answer a question, you can always email us at the email address that Antonia just said. Because I've forgotten what it is. So you can just say it again.
Triggerwarning2a@gmail.com. Don't forget the 2A. I'm pretty sure there's 500 trigger warning podcasts out there. So we got to add the 2A.
The sad part about that is that I set up the email address.
So yeah, I know. I was going to say.
But yeah, triggerwarning2a@gmail.com. Send us an email with your questions. And we'll see you with Katie Malone on Monday night or Tuesday night.
Rachel,
I'm sorry. I have a friend named Katie Malone. That's why. Rachel Malone's better.
Yeah. We love you, Rachel.
We do.
It's also 1:30 o'clock a.m. here. So forgive us for being tired.
I know.
We look cute still.
I know. So that's all I'm going to say.
We did a hair flip at the same time. And all the guys leave. Whatever that leaving sound is. So anyways, this is Trigger Warning with Antonia Okafor.
And Nina Prevo, follow us on Twitter and Instagram.
Yes, and we will see you later. Bye, y'all.
Ciao. Bye, guys.